Let me show you how I open the door to my house or to my garage at home with my mobile phone. I open this app where I can type in a PIN, click on this button, and then the door opens. That app is in fact just a web page running on a web server in the cloud. Now, I hear you say, Mark, are you mad? Do you really allow everyone to open the door to your house at night? Of course not. The site is protected with a client certificate. That means that my phone is the only device on this planet that can browse to that website. Here is how I did it. We had talked about certificates and about this nice GUI here called XCA in the last episode. I showed you how to generate a certificate authority, a CA, and how to generate server certificates. Now, the great thing with X.509 certificates is that we can also use them for client authentication. That means that the web server would only answer requests coming from a device that has the right certificate. All others will be rejected. Imagine how you could secure, for example, your Nextcloud instance, your personal photo collection, or, like I do, simple apps to interface with your IoT at home in a way that only you can use them from your tablet or phone. If you browse to my GitHub repository, then you can find an example for nodejs that does exactly what I showed here. It shows a web page with the two input lines for a PIN and two buttons. In order to use it, you will need a host with nodejs installed. Windows, macOS, or Linux, it doesn't matter. Just copy the files to a subdirectory and start node-testserver.js. The server now answers requests on port 8443. So if you now browse to, let's say, https://testserver:8443/form, then you will most probably get a certificate warning. In the CA subdirectory, you can find a self-signed certificate authority, a CA, that you can import into your browser. In Chrome and Firefox, this is done under the security settings. Alternatively, if you want to run this on a server with valid Let's Encrypt certificates or the like, just replace the files server.crt and server.key with a certificate and private key of your real server. Don't replace the ca.crt file as it is used for client authentication. The files server.crt and server.key in the CA subdirectory have been signed with the ca.crt for testing purposes. If you want to test without certificate warning, then you could just make an entry into your host file and point test server to any host, for example, your local host, by adding the following into your /etc/hosts file on Linux or your C, Windows, System 32 drivers, etc. host file on Windows. If you now browse to the URL again, then your browser should tell you that you have been rejected, as you don't have the right client certificate installed. That's the purpose of this exercise. In order to gain access, you need to import the file testuser.py12 from the xca.db subdirectory into your browser. Let me do this. I go again into the security settings of my browser, then import the certificate. The password for this is just hello. Let me open the page again. And now the magic happens. My browser tells me that the server is requesting authentication. It asks me which certificate I should provide. If I now select the test user certificate, then the page opens. I can use it as desired, without having to type any username or password, without using a VPN, just plain TLS certificates, very transparent. On my phone, it would just use the certificate without asking. So, how can we generate our own client certificates then? Just like in the last episode, we will use XCA for this. You could do this on the command line as well with OpenSSL, of course. Launch XCA and open the xca.db file from my GitHub. This already contains some sample data. As you can see, there is a CA, a server certificate, and also a client certificate. How did I generate the client certificate? Well, pretty much like the server certificate in the last episode. I clicked on New Certificate. Just this time, I chose and applied the TLS client template. As a common name this time, I just entered the name test user. And of course, this one also needs a key, so I generated a new one. In order to be able to use this with my web browser or phone, I exported it as PKCS12 file, because that file format contains both the key and the certificate. And also, I know that my iPhone can read that type of certificate files. As there is a private key inside, I now need to protect it with a password. The password for all the sample data on my GitHub is just hello. You might have doubts on the security of this, and you are right to challenge that. We should not take security lightly. In a nutshell, the certificate is just another authentication factor. An authentication factor can be something you know, such as a username and password, it can be something that you are, so biometric data, or it can be something you have, like a key, a token, or a certificate. So if you wanted to, let's say, make the admin frontend of your Nextcloud or photo sharing app or anything else super secure, then I would not ask you to remove or replace the password authentication, but rather add the client certificate requirement on top of it. That would reduce the surface that you potentially expose to hackers by a huge percentage. I'd say above 99% really. Why? If you have services running in the web, be it a password protected website or an SSH server or whatever, then you will see hundreds, if not thousands, of log entries from people or bots attempting to connect to it every single day. They get to the login prompt and now they can start guessing passwords or using cross-site scripts or injection attacks to your frontend. If you had that site locked down with a client certificate, then all these attempts would not even get to that page on the application layer because they would be rejected by TLS a layer below, on the presentation layer, between the TCP protocol and the application. Still, there are remaining attack vectors. If someone gained control over the server, then they could of course do whatever they wanted there. You still need to secure the server. If someone had gained control over your client, then they could potentially steal the client certificate and use it. If someone is able to get into the middle between you and the server, then they can potentially intercept data as well and exploit weaknesses of the protocol. Last but not least, if someone had a day zero exploit to TLS, or if you used an old version of TLS that has known vulnerabilities, then they could use that as well. But still, the security level is not worse with certificates than it was without certificates. All these attack vectors can be exploited with or without certificates. The main challenge with this concept, however, is the distribution of the client certificates. Not a big thing if you need to put it into one single web browser. But how would you distribute these, let's say, to 10 or 100 clients? And how would you distribute them to, let's say, an iPhone? In an enterprise environment, those devices would be managed by a central mobile device management platform, such as Intune or Altiris or the like. In the home environment, this is a challenge though. Let me first quickly show you how it should not be done. I'll attach the PKCS-12 file, which includes the certificate and the private key, to an email and send that email to my mobile phone. Now, this is great in the sense that I can now easily open and install the certificate. But even though the PKCS12 format is password protected, this is a weak protection, especially if you choose a super weak password like 12345 or hello. This would actually open an additional attack vector, the interception of the certificate. So, how to deal with this? In a real-life secure scenario, the private keys should never ever leave the system where they have been generated on. Now, I do not have an app that allows me to generate keys on my iPhone, so let me show you this with two instances of XCA instead. One instance would be the client, who wants to have a client certificate signed by the CA. Let's call him Mark. That's me. And the other instance would be the site that has the private key for the CA. Let's call it 1mark50.com. So, first, I would download the CA certificate from 1mark50.com, the the public part, without the private key. Then I would generate a private key, which I would want to use with that certificate. Now, rather than creating a certificate, which I could not sign anyhow because I don't have 1Mark50.com's private key, I would now generate a certificate signing request, a CSR. That CSR contains the public key that complements my private key. And I would then submit that CSR to 1Mark50.com. So let me export this on Mark's side and then import it on 1Mark50.com's side. On the 1Mark50.com side, this CSR can now be signed with their CA. That generates a certificate below the CA here. Now, 1Mark50 would export that ready-made certificate, which now contains the public keys of Mark and of the 1Mark50.com CA. But still, no private key has been transferred. 1Mark50.com sent me that certificate and I'll import it. Because I do have my own private key plus the public key of the CA, the certificate will now be properly linked to the CA and I can use it. You could, in theory, do that workflow over email. I would really not recommend it, but you could. No secret information was transmitted at any point in time. Just a thoroughly forged man-in-the-middle attack could still be possible. A malicious attacker who has access to your email could replace your request with their own and hence get granted access to 1Mark50.com. Also, some information that you transfer with a CSR could be used to lower the effort for brute forcing the encryption. Please remember that most successful attacks do not attack the encryption, they rather try to circumvent it. And many popular attacks in the past aimed at the authentication process. That means the part of the process where you prove that you are authorized to obtain a certificate. If you send the CSR via email, then the only authentication is your email address. The CA can't verify your key. There is actually free and open source software available for that type of workflow. Have a look at OpenXPKI, for example. You can self-host this software. For testing purposes, there is a demo site where we can actually log in with demo accounts and submit CSRs and they'll sign it for us. So I create a CSR. Export it. I generate a request on the OpenXPKI platform. Now, here I am at the same time the officer who approves this request, normally that would be a third person. And now I can download the signed certificate from here. So if I made the access to that site quite secure with, let's say, an additional second factor, such as a one-time password or a temporary code sent via text message at least, or the site would only be available in the internet, for example, then I could make that quite secure by home or small business standards. If I go back to the initial application that I have shown in the beginning, then we could even take this blueprint further. Many home automation products can use MQTT as a protocol. Let's say you have your MQTT server running here at home in a container or on your router. And here on the other end, we are in the internet, so outside of the LAN. In order to open the door at home, we need to publish a command to MQTT. Now here, we could have a VPS, a cloud server for a dollar or a free Oracle instance or the like that has Let's Encrypt server certificates. If we add a self-signed CA here, then we can do the following. Our MQTT at home could communicate over TLS with an MQTT instance here on the VPS. Our phone could securely connect to a little nodejs server here using client certificates and issue the command to the local MQTT, which would in turn relay the command to the MQTT at home, which would then instruct the home automation to open the door. No passwords, no VPN, no hole in the firewall, no port forwarding, nothing. Just the right certificates at the right place. Guys, we're running out of time. Let me know if you like this episode. Leave me a comment if you want follow-ups. All links and the example code are in the description and on my GitHub server. In any case, thank you so much for watching. Stay safe, stay healthy. Bye for now.